I don't need anything. All I need is more popcorn.
Hi. It feels like it's been forever since it was only now 11 months ago that we saw you guys in Sundance with this movie, and it was the little movie that could there, and now it's become this year-long adventure into award season. A little surreal.
You're so cool about it.
Well, it's we just enjoy it and celebrate and enjoy every step of the way, because eventually we will be working on something else. So it's just about getting the best out of the situation as it is now, popcorn and everything.
So is it fun? I mean, you guys have gone through almost every festival in the world, it seems like, and you've been promoting constantly.
It's relieving, and it's good to be able to get a chance to talk about the film, to explain that that the film has layers and that it's complex, so that people will get more out of it, and hopefully more people will see it.
So it kind of feels like people get it. I mean, that's the thing.
It
about
does. That's a good thing about sometimes being with an audience, is that you can hear that people laugh at the right places or the places you hope they would.
And does it play everywhere the same, or has it been a little different, different cities, different countries?
Tiny differences.
Yes.
Different, I mean, slightly different reactions to some of the more intimate stuff in different places. I went to a couple of places in Australia where people gasped more than they gasp in England. That kind of thing. But only in Brisbane, people went like, what? So really? Brisbane for some reason. And then I said that in Melbourne, when I got to Melbourne, they were like, yeah, well, that's Brisbane. And they all kind of play off each other to how they react. Quite fun.
So they're freaks in Australia.
Yeah.
What about other kind? How's it played in England? How's that experience been?
I haven't watched it.
That's different as well, because the English, I mean, I think if you're not in England, you tend to laugh a little bit more at the English, mm-hmm. whereas in England, people are more part of it and see different things and identify with different details. But I think it works. It works both ways. I hope so, since I'm not English.
But I think in England, it's more like people go, "Oh yeah, that's what." Like when my parents were, they were like, "Ha ha, yeah, but you know, it's that kind of laugh." Rather than ha-ha, it's like ha-ha-ha. Yeah.
Yeah, that was my school uniform exactly.
Yeah,
yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's right. They nailed that bit. Like that kind of reaction.
They're not laughing because it's you doing it. It's laughing because...
Because it's, you know, it's identical. Yeah, I think.
Do they see you in it? I mean, how do they react to this movie?
Who?
Your parents.
Oh, my parents? Well, the first couple of times they watch it, they just can't, you know, they can't kind of... They're only watching me. It's like they see me on a stage doing like a school play, and they're hoping I don't forget my lines. You know, they're still thinking that. And then I think it's become easier. My mum took my old French teacher and choir mistress, Mrs. J, who's this Scottish woman who runs the church choir at my local church, the kids' choir. And she's who basically got me into acting. So I started singing with her when I was like 7, and then I sang, and then I acted. And she took Mrs. J to go to see it. And Mrs. J cried at the end, and then she said, I honestly believe she got into Oxford, and she kind of forgot that it was me, which is nice. But I don't think my parents can separate from it, you know.
And do you see yourself every time you watch it now, or do you watch it anymore?
I can't remember. I think I watched it in Toronto was the last time I watched it. Toronto was the last time.
And were you guys in Roy Thompson, or were you in Elgin, or...? Was it a really big theater you saw it in?
In Toronto, where were we? It was like a student. It was, yeah, it was quite big. And we were sat kind of in the middle of it.
Right. That's kind of become the hip theater. Ryerson.
Yes, the Ryerson. Yeah, yeah, that's where we were.
They seemed to get a younger, kind of funnier crowd.
And I think sitting in the middle of the audience sort of is like, laugh. You know, because everyone around you then goes, oh God, the cast right there. So I was in Melbourne and Quentin Tarantino. I went to the Inglourious Basterds premiere in Melbourne. and Quentin Tarantino did this introduction. He charmed everybody. And then he went up and he sat right in the middle of the audience. I thought that was so smart, because then like all the Quentin Tarantino enthusiasts are like so psyched to be sitting next to him, and then they're all like supercharged. I don't think we had quite the same effect on our audience, but it was still still nice.
So have you guys gotten used to that? I mean, you in particular, you've been through the journey a few times, but I mean, has this been head spinning for you? I mean, you still seem like it was so new back at Sundance, and now you seem to be very kind of like you figured it out.
Oh no.
Not that you've changed, but that you figured it out at least.
Sundance, I mean, not much of it has been on my own since then. I mean, I went to Australia with my best friend, and that was like a big holiday. Mm-hmm. But the rest of it's been with all of us, like a big gang. So it's never been like me on my own, really. So, no, I mean, I'm more comfortable with some stuff than I was back then. But I've been working since Sundance anyway. I did Never Let Me Go, and then I did Wall Street. So it hasn't all been just about this. I've always had a job to go back to. Mm-hmm. So it's all been fitted in around working, which is, you know, so it's not become like the center of the universe.
And was Wall Street off of this, or was Wall Street off of the theater? Or?
Wall Street was off of this, yeah.
Off of this?
Yeah.
So is that a funny feeling? The propulsion of, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Completely mad. And also, I'd Never Let Me Go. I mean, I did audition for Never Let Me Go. So Wall Street was the first thing where I'd been offered a job without having to audition, which was, you know, really weird. And also kind of more scary, because in a way you don't feel like you've earned your position there. So you get on set and you think, I've got to be really good now, otherwise, you know, then they've just hired me off the back of some tape they've seen, and how awful if I don't live up to it, you know, or if I just happen to be good in one thing and I'm going to be crap in this. And so it's kind of that kind of, it's more pressure when you don't have to work for it and you feel really like unqualified. It's quite scary.
So you, Lone, that's kind of what the life of a director is. I mean, your movies are your calling card, and they're not judging you as an individual. You know, they can't pick out that performance or that moment. It's the whole movie, really.
Yeah, and I'm primarily just going step by step, trying to expand my expression, get better resources, better scripts, better budgets. I don't feel I'm competing with anyone but myself. It's more about giving, sharing something with the audience that that drives me. It's not, the ambition is more on behalf of every moment in a film than being career oriented.
Well, have you felt the difference in the industry in terms of responding to this? You're getting seen more, or are they talking to you more?
Well, we've talked a couple of times, haven't we?
Yes, we have. Are they sending you? They don't want you to do Armageddon 2, I imagine, but.
No,
do
but
one of those movies.
If I play my cards right, maybe Armageddon 3.
You can blow up some stuff.
Jaws 7. How many Jaws movies is there?
I think there are 5 so far. I don't know. They're always talking about another one. But I mean, it does seem, it's an interesting thing. This movie came along and is such a beloved of the audiences who are seeing it. And yet at the same time, people are talking about drama dying, and, you know, people don't want to go to the theater to see a drama anymore. But are you feeling that? Are you trying to fund your next project, or are you?
I do think people want to go to the theater and see a drama, and that they eventually will see it. But the pattern how people consume films is different. And I think maybe I'm more optimistic than a lot of other people. There are fantastic films coming from Europe this year, and there are good scripts in circulation, and there's a lot of talent, and there's a willingness to accept new talent at a speed that I've never experienced. For instance, the way Carey's career has exploded in a really short time. Of course, that has to do with Carey, but it may also have to do with the way people, the media is changing slightly.
Is that good
but
or
bad? We all still love to go to the cinema. It's not, I mean, there is reason for optimism.
Well, it does seem like when you give them what they want, they find it. somehow. I mean, I guess Blindside being the most recent example of a $100 million plus movie that's really nothing but a straight drama, ultimately. And this movie is, you know, also moving. People are running to go see this.
Yeah, but it has a bit of comedy in it, yeah. I hope. So.
Well, you have hope.
But you don't only go to the cinema to laugh. You do go to have something in common with other people, pain and sorrow as well. And I just think you need to communicate to people that they'll be in good hands and you're not going to do anything that's destructive or harmful or unpleasant, but that you will be emotional, and that's fine.
Do you find that critics, I mean, this is one of my pet peeves lately, is that critics seem to dislike emotion on some profound level, like if you make them feel too much, they rebel against you and they want to kill your movie. And if you...
I've never tried that, because the only real genre films I've done have been commercials. And,
right.
And I don't think anyone is trying to tell me not to make the audience feel.
Yeah. Well, this movie, I guess.
I'm also not that much of a comedy director, though people do laugh at here and there in the films. But real genuine farce, I haven't done since I was 35, which is a long, long time ago.
Do you want to get back to it? Or things you want to do that are specific, that besides specific projects, do you have?
It is fantastic to make people laugh, and it's wonderful to shoot things that make people laugh. But I think this, if this film does anything to my career, it probably is a chance to not do that, to maybe do something that is more courageous and dare to do a full-blooded, totally emotional film, but it's not my next project. The next project I'm doing is probably fairly light as well. I think light films about heavy subjects, that's a good thing.
That's interesting. And do you want to do a straight-out comedy?
No.
Really, no? Because you have, I mean, you're kind of already known for your charm, which oh. Everybody talks about.
Oh, no, I said this last night. I find comedy really terrifying. I'm much, much happier doing drama. I would have cried the whole way through the last half of the movie if Lone hadn't stopped me, because there were so many scenes that were emotional, and Lone kept saying that we had to, you know, because if I'd gone and wept the whole way through it, no one would have cared. And so that all had to be kind of measured. I'm much happier doing sad, you know, dramatic things than I am doing comedy. Comedy really scares me. I think it's really, really hard to do.
Do you like being scared as an actor?
Do I like being
scared?
Yeah.
But not that much.
No, I don't know. I mean, it doesn't. It depends on what the script was. I don't know. I think it's really rare that they ever work comedies. I think I find it sometimes. I just don't think they're funny. I don't. You know. I just. There aren't very many, are there, that work like brilliantly, that make you laugh.
Well, lots. I'm. You know. I can laugh at a bad joke.
No, I can laugh at like this is so bad it's funny. But I can't. I don't know. I'm just scared of it. I've always been scared of it. I had to do like one of the third play I did was a second play I did was a farce, a Molière play, and I hated it, the whole thing. And I never felt comfortable. I never thought like, oh, I've got it now. I always hated it, and I got through it, but bad in it.
And also there's a really big difference between something that you want to see and
a
year of your life on, no
yeah.
more.
We're getting a little buzz off your microphone. Sorry.
What, popcorn?
No, I think from the mic rubbing against the necklace.
Oh.
Sorry about that.
It's okay.
The things you never think of.
It's all that jewelry you're on.
Dripping in jewelry.
Is that better?
We're good.
Sorry.
So, but I assume that, like, you know, studios, there's the chick flick movies, I guess, the movies with some star in the front center and doing something wacky and falling in love in the third act and all that stuff. I assume you started to get those. Even if they're not good, which almost none of them are.
I don't know. I think there's, I haven't found what I want to do next. Mm-hmm. I've read lots of things, but yeah, there are those kind of films, but I mean, some of them are really like Devil Wears Prada is that kind of movie in a way, and I loved it. You know, there are some movies that really work like that, and then, but you don't necessarily know that they're going to work.
But nobody says, okay, let's make a really bad film. Let's find a not very good script, cast it with mediocre actors, and cheat the audience. It's you always think it's going to be good and believe that this one is edgier or more special and the characterization is deeper and that these actors will swim in that genre. So each script is different, and the fact that romantic comedies are so formulaic in a way is a really interesting challenge. Mm-hmm. But there are probably only so many variations of that theme.
Well, the Dogma thing really did kind of break that mold quite a bit.
Oh, but then you had to sign a document promising not to do a genre film, and romantic comedy is definitely a genre, a very basic, rule-oriented genre, more than maybe any other genre at all.
But Lars has broken the rules, don't you agree that probably everybody can break the rules now, no?
Well, everybody can, you're the only judge of it, and there's no dogma police and never has been, but it was much more, you got much more out of it if you really tried to go for it and obey those rules and mm-hmm. that vow of chastity. It was great fun, but it's very soon 15 years ago.
Yeah, well, it's an odd thing though that Hollywood has its own set of rules and kind of people say this is bad or this is good or whatever, but it's very, you realize how many different color palettes there are.
And it's inspiring. I mean, if you don't get rules, you make up a set of rules yourself and call it concept or take or, but it's rules. Mm-hmm. But you don't necessarily need to tell other people which rules you've made up for yourself or which right. things you've decided would be the things that you primarily want to tell, because you can't tell everything with every film. You need to tell little well instead of just ice skating around a lot of thematic and aesthetic ground. Mm-hmm.
But you only have so many films to do it in, I guess, as a filmmaker. I mean, as an actor, you can work in two or three films a year.
Yeah, but as a director, you can continue until you're way up in your 80s. Well, actors mm-hmm. can too, and also you're not so dependent on other people wanting you to work. You can just do it, especially if you're in Europe. Mm.
So is it still a big difference? I mean, I feel like kind of independent film in America has suffered partially through financing issues, and European films have actually kind of become the new independent cinema of America in a way. I mean, you look at Sundance, for instance, the films that were kind of the hot films, including your film, really weren't American-based films. They were either British or French or Italian or...
I don't know, because I wouldn't know if the financial crisis was already in Sundance almost a year ago. I right. would say next time maybe you can really see a pattern. Because the change has almost happened after January, hasn't it?
I think it kind of happened a little before. I mean, the buying was certainly destroyed at Sundance this year to a great extent.
Yes, but the production, in which way it's going to influence the production, I think you're going to see from now on, maybe. Mm. And it probably is true that if you produce less out of the United States this year, that leaves more space for films from countries you normally wouldn't see films from, because people mm. haven't stopped going to the cinema. But I think you have so much talent in this country. You always had, and it's a very big country, and mm. people have, there's so many individual interesting voices. And I think there's going to still be the someone willing to run the financial risk of supporting a new talent. It's always interesting to invent somebody.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's a lot of I mean, we certainly steal foreigners all the time in this country in terms of new filmmakers. I mean, a lot of our best filmmakers are not from here, and they're now seen as Hollywood filmmakers. There are a few that are like Steven Spielberg who are actually here, but most of them are from somewhere else. But I guess that goes back to the 30s and 40s, really. Billy Wilder and all
and
that.
Even earlier, yeah.
Yeah. So we kind of suck. So in all of this, do you guys have a chance to go to the movies for just pleasure this year?
The festivals, yeah.
You go to see movies when you go to festivals?
Well, at this time I've had a chance to. I've been in the jury at a festival and yes. And all these hotel rooms that you stay in, then you get to and flights because we have traveled a lot. Then you get to see many films
in the hotel room on TV.
Some, yeah.
So you see.
I know it's not fair to your colleagues to see their films that way, but it's better than not seeing them at all.
That's true. And Carey, you get to go to the movies much?
Mm-hmm.
So what do you like? What kind of stuff do you like? You don't have to name names if you don't want. Or you could.
Fantastic Mr. Fox. I love that. Mm-hmm. I've been loads. I like The Informant.
You like The Road?
I love The Road. We saw The Road in Telluride. I love The Road.
There's a movie where I feel like critics, or some certain group of critics, felt something in that movie and were afraid of it.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
And tried to kill it.
Well, I loved it. I did weep the whole way through.
Yeah.
But I like that.
You seen The Proposition?
Yeah.
Yeah. Another, I think, a great movie.
I think he's brilliant.
He really is.
I think Michael Haneke's film.
Oh, I really want to see that. I haven't seen that. The White Ribbon.
The French masterpiece The White Ribbon. Probably the best two films of the year.
Have you seen Terribly Happy?
Oh, of course I have. Of course I have. It's going to be remade now here, I think.
Sound is suddenly become an issue.
I'm being sound.
There you go.
Thank you. And you're also being makeup.
Yes.
Well, you both look lovely. So do you feel like you're kind of coming to the end of this particular road? I mean, has it been enough now and you're ready to focus on the next thing? I mean, obviously it's lovely to be awarded and beloved and you're going to have to suffer through another 3 months of that, but is it kind of like deep breath, time to move on?
Well, it's making the films and seeing the films that I really like, but it is okay to talk about it and be the object of all this attention and see you, and it's fine. It's nice to have this kind of variation in your work life and to have this rhythm to what you do. But yes, I do love shooting and I can't wait to do it soon again.
Is it like watching your kids grow up? And is that are you Fred's mom here?
No, not at all. It's but it's the second best.
There's a great deal of joy in it, I guess.
Yes, there
have
is.
You've all been traveling all over the place together, or have there been like large chunks of you?
Most of us have done. Now it's just you and me for this week. But for LA and New York, for those premieres, it was pretty much all of us. And then we were all there in London on the weekend for the Independent Film Awards. And we were all in Toronto. You know, give or take a few here and there.
One drops in, one drops out. And what have there been big surprises along the way? Has anything been really kind of, besides the initial wave of, oh my God, it's going to be beloved?
It's all been surprising to me. I remember when it sold, me and Dominic went out and had sushi and sake, a lot of. And then we went to this UK Film Council party and we went running up to you and we were like, Loud, it sold, the movie sold. And you were like, yep. And we were like, no, that's so exciting. And you were like, that's what happens. I was like, what? So the whole thing for me has been like explosions all the time and you just kind of cruise through it with your handgun, like, yeah. You're cool with the whole thing, it's amazing. I'm not cool at all.
Do you still get uncool, or are you still as excited when things come?
Yeah, it's. I mean, it's not like the center of the universe, but I do. I mean, for me, it's just bypassed a lot of kind of, you know, because it was just before this, it was just getting into the room to even get an audition was just impossible in a lot of cases, and And so this has just changed that, and that's what I'm doing. It's just, it's exciting to get to, you know, meet, work with the people I've got, and play this year. I love them. I did this. And then this has been all nice, because I've really never done a job before where I've got to come back and spend time with people after we wrap. You know, I've kept a few friends from jobs here and there, but this, I've seen these guys, and I've loved them. I don't want that to... Nick said at one point, oh, this is the last time we'll all be together, and I was almost cried. No, it's horrible. So I don't want to.
And do an annual reunion.
Yeah, I know. But I love all that, you know.
Is there an ideal method or situation? Or?
With you. Forever. I don't know. No, I mean.
How big a thing is that? How big is the director who's, you know?
That's big.
The family of the set and.
Yeah, that's the well. I love, because I didn't have, you know, a huge part in Wall Street, but I was on set most days, because I discovered in our film that I told him before we started shooting I was quite scared of cameras and that I needed to know the camera crew. Don't you remember? I wanted to know John and the focus puller, and I said, it's really, I think I need to know them, otherwise I feel like they're standing behind the camera with a notepad writing down how bad I am. And I've got really from the camera team and the crew, and of course it's ridiculous because they're all doing their own jobs, but so on Wall Street I went in every day, and it'll never let me go every day anyway, but on Wall Street I went in every day, and so I shot my stuff. It wasn't like, oh, she's just the supporting actress who comes in and does stuff. It's because I was there. I knew them and they were my friends. And so I think the crew is really important to me. Just, you know, anyway, it's nice to have friends and to meet people. Your job's so much easier because you feel comfortable and then they're all rooting for you and you're not just the random who comes in and does stuff. So, but I don't know. But I think director's important because with all day, we got to the end of the film, kind of nodded, just doing a little instinctive sound check here. I'm such a pro now, I'm so used to this.
I'm so good at instinctive sound checks.
It's part of my repertoire, white people, yeah.
I know, that's one of your really big virtues.
One of my big virtues. But when I look over, you know, because the worst thing is to get in the car at the end of the day and feel like something's been immortalized that you're not happy with. And the best thing about us working together is that when I looked over at Lone, I'd know if she was happy. If she was moving on, it was because she got it and she was happy. And that security is like gold dust, because the paranoia you can put yourself through is a nightmare. And on stage, you hate yourself because you can't do anything about it. And 1,000 people have that burned into their brains. And so I think director's vital, because you've got to feel like they'll never leave anything until they're happy, and their happiness has to be the same standard that you judge yourself at. And if you're very critical of yourself, that person needs to be very critical of you as well.
And does the adventure of not knowing whether that's going to be the case when you take on a new director?
I don't like that adventure.
You don't want that adventure.
That's why I did a film with Oliver Stone. I was like, Oliver, he's done it for ages.
You know exactly what you're
doing. Yeah.
But you have influence on it.
It's not just directors who influence the actors. It's all you set that agenda as well.
How do you mean?
Well, we can talk about that later.
People have tuned in for that.
And we'll talk about that privately. Yeah.
Whole better, much
Let's
show.
Do more sound checks now.
Split instinct sound check.